Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Letters to a Young Poet, with the letters to Rilke from the young poet, by Rainer Maria Rilke and Franz Xaver Kappus. Translated by Damion Searls. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Introduction. Rilke's Letters to a Young Poet have spoken powerfully and differently to every generation of readers since they were first published in German in 1929. They have been seen as a record of the great man's own development, written to a young poet, but also by a young poet going through serious personal and artistic crises of his own. Rilke had recently turned 27 when he wrote his first letter. They have been taken as a spiritual guide, a source of insight, inspiration, and encouragement for any young person struggling with loneliness and doubt, questions of his or her fate, and of what interpersonal and sexual relationships might have the potential to be. They were an inspiration to Marilyn Monroe, Jane Fonda, and the inventor of the programmable computer who bought the book in 1929. Dustin Hoffman called it his Bible. Lady Gaga had a line from it tattooed on her arm. Today, even though the Letters to a Young Poet have been in print for nearly a century and translated into English more than half a dozen times, we have the chance to see them afresh in a genuinely new way with the discovery and publication of the other half of the story, the letters that the young poet, Franz Xaver Kappus, wrote to Rilke. In this edition, the Letters to a Young Poet are for the first time a two-way conversation, a true dialogue. As recently as 2018, scholars and translators were saying in print that these letters to Rilke did not survive, but in fact, they've been in the private Rilke family archive in Germany all along, waiting for someone to find them. A Rilke scholar named Eric Unglaub got permission from Rilke's heirs to look at Kappus's letters from the archive, and the press, Wallstein Verlag, published them in German for the first time in March 2019. The translation in your hands would not have been possible without Eric Unglaub's and Wallstein Verlag's generous assistance, and I would like to thank them both. Unglaub's edition of the missing half of the correspondence solves several mysteries of Letters to a Young Poet. It turns out that Rilke and the young poet did meet in person. We now know more of what lay behind the long gap in the correspondence between 1904 and 1908. This information is in my biographical afterword. There is even a lost 11th letter from Rilke, though only tantalizing glimpses of it remain. More importantly, Rilke's pronouncements from on high have turned into answers, sensitively directed not just toward young aspiring artists in general, but at a very particular person we can now see clearly. It has been easy to think that Rilke was writing his letters to a kind of younger version of himself. It's now clearer that Kappus was quite a different person. The connections between Rilke and Kappus are ones that Rilke largely creates, rather than finding them ready-made in their life histories. And while many of the topics in the Letters to a Young Poet are actually introduced by Kappus, irony, sex, uncomprehending relatives, the loss of a sense of God, there are others that Rilke declines to take up. For example, many literary matters, including questions about his own works, which he leaves to Kappus to read for himself, as well as things he chooses to bring up on his own, such as his feminist discussion of women's identity. Rilke's message is the same whether or not we read Kappus's letters, but with the full correspondence, it is much easier to see Rilke's priorities. What he thinks is important, and how he thinks it will speak to his reader. Rilke's emphasis on solitude in Letters to a Young Poet has also been easy to overplay. The biographical facts, with Rilke often living separately from his wife and having more or less abandoned their infant daughter, certainly cast him as an arrogant and needy rejecter of intimacy. But what will be interesting to today's generation, I feel, is how Rilke's advice to Kappus addresses the interplay between inner and outer, between going into oneself and achieving a more intimate contact with the outside world and other people. Rilke's solitude was one that paradoxically, or perhaps not so paradoxically, let him speak to individual readers with extraordinary intimacy. The American poet Robert Haas said of Rilke, "His poems have the feeling of being written from a great depth in himself. What makes them so seductive is that they also speak to the reader so intimately. They seem whispered or crooned into our inmost ear." As someone else once wrote, "It is as though one were reading the work inside oneself. So much does it arise from the depths of our intimate experience." Except that was Marcel Proust, giving a perfect description of his own writing, except he was actually describing Henry David Thoreau's Walden, whose voice Proust found so remarkable that at one point he considered translating Walden into French. Walden by Proust. Imagine. All three of these writers were deeply indebted to Ralph Waldo Emerson. Thoreau personally. Proust's first book quotes Emerson many times and is overwhelmed by his influence. Rilke got his Emerson largely through Nietzsche, also very much an Emerson disciple in his early writings. Rilkean solitude is as complex and ultimately social as the self-reliance championed by Emerson. In an urban, industrial world seeming to lack satisfactory religious answers to the ultimate questions, all these figures felt the need to look within themselves for forces and truths that could connect them to other people. They found spaces to retreat to, a cabin in the Massachusetts woods, a cork-lined room in Paris, or the more abstract vastness Rilke describes so often in these letters. And they did so, yes, to avoid other people, but also to reach them. As Rilke argues in Letter 8, what seems to impinge from without actually emerges from within. His concern with how to do artistic work and his focus on solitude, the two main centers of gravity in earlier readings of the Letters to a Young Poet, are linked by an even more central piece of advice: that the young poet wait. From the very beginning, what Rilke praises is quiet, hidden beginnings. In Letter 4, he tells Kappus, "Don't look for the answers now. They cannot be given to you yet, because you cannot yet live them." He ends their main correspondence with, "The same as what I've said before. I hope that you can find in yourself enough patience to endure these things." The point of solitude is to give yourself time to grow in your own way, while the ultimate goal remains the difficult task of love and connection. To go with the literal dialogue in this new edition, I have translated Rilke's prose into a more straightforward voice than he is often given in English. This direct, vigorous style, together with the presence of Kappus's letters, is meant to give listeners a better sense of Rilke the real person, in real conversation. All the old pleasures of Rilke's Letters to a Young Poet are still here. Readers have always felt Rilke talking directly to them, and the fact that he is answering someone else's questions, responding to someone else's problems, should not detract from this sense of personal connection. And since the young poet's letters are simply not as good as Rilke's, how could they be? They both make Rilke's empathy and artistry more impressive and risk interrupting it. The editors and I have therefore put Kappus's letters in a separate section to encourage listeners, especially new listeners, to experience Rilke's iconic 10 letters as the single work of art they have always been. Those interested in the dialogue with Kappus can skip back and forth to follow the correspondence in order. Other translations of the Letters to a Young Poet tend not to include footnotes, and for good reason. What Rilke himself doesn't explain to his less knowledgeable correspondent about, say, the writers he's recommending is not really worth explaining. The magic of place names like Viareggio or Boibe Gord Fladia is more evocative and powerful than factual information about what Rilke was doing in Italy or Sweden. Kappus, however, mentions more things and drops more names, and the existence of Kappus's letters grounds the whole correspondence more firmly in time and place. This is the first complete edition in English, or nearly complete. Only the young poet's first letter to Rilke was missing from the Rilke family archive. In the autumn of 1902, Franz Xaver Kappus, a 19-year-old cadet at the Theresian Military Academy in Wiener Neustadt, Austria, was reading a book of Rilke's poetry when a passing professor caught sight of it and told Kappus that he had taught the poet himself at a lower school more than 10 years before. Encouraged by the personal connection, Kappus wrote to Rilke, sending him copies of his own fledgling poems and pouring his heart out for advice. "Never before and never again in my life," he would later write, "did I reveal myself to another person as openly and unreservedly as in that first letter to him." A few months later, Rilke answered. Letters to a Young Poet. Letter 1. Paris, February 17, 1903. Dear Sir, your letter reached me only a few days ago. It shows a great and open-hearted trust in me, for which I thank you, but there is not much more I can do. I cannot analyze the nature of your poetry. Efforts at criticism are alien to me. When we try to get at a work of art, words of criticism fail worse than anything. They give rise only to more or less happy misunderstandings. The things of this world are not all as sayable and graspable as people usually want us to think. Most of what happens is unsayable, unfolding in a space no word has ever entered. And the most unsayable of all are works of art. Those mysterious creatures whose life endures alongside our own life, which is so fleeting. Having prefaced my letter with these comments, perhaps I might add that the poems you sent me have no nature of their own, no individual style, but they do have the quiet, hidden beginnings of something personal. I feel these stirrings most clearly in the last poem, My Soul. There, something of yours is trying to find its language and its melody. And in the lovely poem To Leopardi, a kind of affinity with that great lonely poet may be starting to appear. Still, the poems, even those two, have not become their own independent things. And the warm, accompanying letter you sent sheds light on some of the shortcomings I felt in reading the poems without being able to put my finger on them. You ask in that letter if your poetry is good. You ask me. You have already asked other people. You send in your poems to magazines. You compare them to other poems. You are upset when this or that editor rejects your efforts. So now, since you have asked for my advice, here is what I want you to do. Stop all that. You are looking outward, and that, more than anything, is what you should not be doing. No one can help you or give you advice. No one. The only thing to do is go into yourself. Look for the reason that is making you write. See whether it has put down roots in the deepest place in your heart. Admit, in all honesty, whether or not you would die if you weren't allowed to write. This above all. Ask yourself in your night's quietest moment, do I have to write? Dig deep down into yourself for the answer. And if it is yes, if you can meet this solemn question with a strong and simple, I must, then build your life around that necessity. Your whole life, down to its most trivial, indifferent moments, must be a sign of this need, a testament to it. Then approach nature. Try, as if no one had tried before, to say what you see and feel and love and lose. Don't write love poems. Avoid for the time being all the facile familiar forms, for they are the most difficult. It takes great mature power to put something of your own into a tradition where there is already so much good, often brilliant material ready to hand. So avoid the general themes and write about what your everyday life has to offer. Describe your sorrows and longings, your passing thoughts, your belief in this or that beauty, and describe it with heartfelt, silent, humble sincerity and candor. In expressing yourself, use the things around you, images from your dreams, objects of your memory. If your day-to-day life seems too poor and empty, don't blame it. Blame yourself, and tell yourself you are not poet enough to call forth that life's riches, because for one who creates, there is no poverty, no place that is poor and indifferent. Even if you were in prison, with the walls of your cell keeping out all the sounds of the world, wouldn't you still have your childhood, that priceless royal abundance, that treasure house of memories? Look there. Try to raise up the sunken sensations of that capacious past. Your personality will grow more solid. Your solitude will expand. It will become a place in the dim light where you can live, and the sound of other people will pass by as if at a great distance. Then, if this inward turn, this sinking into your own world, results in poems, it won't even occur to you to ask anyone if they're good. You won't try to place them in magazines either, for you will see them as a beloved natural possession, a piece of, a voice of, your life. A work of art is good when it is necessary, when it comes from a need. This is the only way to judge it, by its origins. And so, dear sir, the only advice I have to give you is to go into yourself and test the depths where your life has its source. This wellspring is where you will find the answer to the question of whether or not you must create. Take the answer as it comes without trying to interpret it. Maybe it will turn out that your vocation is to be an artist. If that is so, take up that destiny and bear it, its burden, its greatness, without ever asking what reward from the outside it might bring you. For he who creates must be a world unto himself, must find everything inside himself and in the nature to which he devotes himself. Or maybe, after this descent into yourself and what is singular within you, you will have to give up on becoming a poet. As I said, if you feel you can live without writing, that alone is enough to mean you mustn't write. But even in that case, this turning inward I am asking you to undertake will not have been in vain. Your life will still find its paths from that point on, and will follow those paths, and may they be good, broad, and rich. I wish that for you more than I can say. What else can I tell you? It seems to me that everything has its own proper emphasis, and my final bit of advice for you is to quietly, in all seriousness, keep growing in your own way. The biggest obstacle to that development would be for you to look outward, to expect outside answers to your questions that only your innermost feelings in your quietest moments have any chance of answering. I was happy to come across Professor Horacek's name in your letter. I continue to hold that kind and learned man in the highest esteem, and I have remained grateful to him through all these years. Please tell him how I feel. It is very good of him to say that he still remembers me, and I appreciate it. I am returning the poems you so kindly entrusted to me, and thank you once more for the great, heartfelt confidence you placed in me. By answering you as honestly as I can, I hope I have shown myself at least a little worthier of this trust than, as a stranger, I actually am. Yours with warmest sympathy, Rainer Maria Rilke. Kappus's reply, February 24th. Letter 2. Viareggio, near Pisa, Italy, April 5th, 1903. You must forgive me, dear sir, for waiting until today to gratefully acknowledge your letter of February 24th. I have not been well. This whole time I've been not exactly sick, but in a flu-like torpor that kept me from doing anything. Finally, since it just wouldn't let up, I came to this southern sea whose beneficial effects I had felt once before. I'm not fully returned to health even now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.